One of the world's greatest performers, Shakira has had the most successful song in the 21st century to date and topped the charts in over 55 countries. She's won 2 Grammy Awards, 7 Latin Grammy Awards, and has been Golden Globe nominated. She is also the highest selling Colombian artist of all time and the second most successful female Latin singer, having sold over 50 million albums worldwide. Today she joins us to talk about something very close to her heart, the Barefoot Foundation, which works to make education available to the least advantaged. Honourable members, Shakira.
Thank you, Oxford, and thank you, Oxford Union. It is truly an honour and a privilege to be here today, and that you have afforded me this opportunity to speak to you. I must confess, I'm somewhat mystified as to why you are here, because there won't be any singing or any hip shaking whatsoever. So, how do I, a girl from Barranquilla, Colombia, come to occupy the same stage as Newton and Churchill? Lord knows I'm no Mother Teresa. But here I am, nonetheless. And I realized that the one point of view from which I can depart is that of an artist. After all, it is who I am, right? We artists depend on our imaginations. When I first learned I was coming, I thought about the past and I imagined the future. From your minds, ideas will sprout that will give new shape to the world. And I cannot help but fast forward to what the world will be like in 50 years. What will be happening? Who will we be? What challenges can we overcome? How will we live? I have a fantasy about this future, and I wanted to share it with you today. Let me put it this way. If civilization were a car, we would have been cruising at 20 miles per hour for millions of years, only to hit light speed in the last 100. So I wonder, what made us accelerate so quickly recently, and how can we continue this pace? There is only one explanation to me, and that is the democratization of education. I strongly believe that the best is yet to come. With universal access to education, to feed our collective intelligence, with our commitment to meet and organize in places like this, with students like you, we could be so close to creating a network of intellect, an enormous think tank, devoted to sharing the best ideas and inspiring each other to keep learning, keep informing, and keep advancing our world, and finding solutions to our common issues. Wouldn't that be great? We have evolved so far in history, with so many technological advances in just the past century. So how will we evolve in the next 10 years, or 20 years, or 50 years? Now that we know that the world has shrunk, and to me, it has practically become just one big neighborhood, you are the architects of change. So tell me, how many things that seem inconceivable today will be obvious tomorrow? How long will man live? How will society be structured? Will we still be organized in couples, in communities, governed by governments? Sadly, at the current pace of change, we won't have universal access to education in 100 years, let alone 5. That is unacceptable. Especially when the world has the resources to feed itself several times over, then why are children starving? Latin America alone has 3 times the necessary abundance to feed its entire population. These children can't wait. They can't wait 100 more years. They need us to cure a child with leukemia or AIDS with a simple pill or with a breakthrough vaccine. We need to live in a world in which together we can find a solution to global warming, so we don't have to worry every time a single storm begins to form on the horizon. We need to find new ways to distribute food so no child goes to bed hungry. And I know that education is our ticket. How do I know? Because I've seen it. I was born and raised in Colombia, a country marked by civil war, civil conflict, social strife, and inequality. Growing up in the developing world, where education is perceived as a luxury and not as a birthright, like it should be, where children beg for an education and parents are desperate to provide it, where if one is born poor, one is destined to die poor. But the good news is that there is an exit strategy to break the cycle of poverty in which millions of people are trapped because of lack of access to education. From the moment I turned 18, I decided to establish my own foundation in Colombia, and since then we've been working on providing high quality education, nutrition for children, and occupational training for the parents. We've been building schools that also work as community centers for families that have been displaced by violence and who have lost everything they had. And we found a way to keep kids in school and maintain parents' involvement in their children's education. By providing nutritious meals in schools, we have decreased the number of dropouts and we have eradicated malnutrition among our students. So we know that creating comprehensive models of education in areas where the population is vulnerable to extreme poverty and conflict transforms the minds of not only the kids, but also the families and entire communities. And it works, believe me, it works. Now, I want to be clear about this. This isn't about charity. This is about investing in human potential. From an ethical point of view, from a moral point of view, it of course accomplishes the purpose, but also from an economic point of view. This could bring enormous benefits to all mankind. Universal education is the key to global security and economic growth. We all want safer nations. And in a world where weak states are often haven for violent extremists, getting more children into school can dramatically help reduce the risk of instability and lay the groundwork for more stable democratic political systems to emerge. A child who lives in extreme poverty, away from school, is 10 times more likely to be recruited by a militant group than one who is receiving an education. For instance, in Colombia, we have kids in our school who were destined to be a part of the drug trafficking business or recruited by guerrillas. However, today, as we speak, those same kids are going to college, just like you, and are graduating soon. So yes, education promotes peace and stability worldwide. One single year of primary education invested in one kid means 10 to 20% increase in the wages in their adult life. And for every dollar invested in early childhood development programs, that same child will give back $17. So yeah, education also boosts economic growth. That is how I want the youth of 2060 to see us. That our mission for global peace consisted of sending 30,000 educators to Afghanistan, not 30,000 soldiers. That in 2010, world education became more important than world domination. Because only education will accelerate our evolution. And because only by investing in our children, by tapping their potential that has remained untapped for far too long, can they one day cure our diseases, or bring us to Mars, or secure us peace here on Earth? Education for all. John Locke, who I believe was one of you, right? once said, the only fence against the world is a thorough knowledge of it, and the earlier the better. So yeah, the earlier the better. There is no time to waste. It is you who are in the driver's seat. It is your foot on the accelerator. And please step on it. Thank you so much. This has been a true honor.